Father, you've given us far more than we could ever deserve, and we're here this morning because of that. God, we want to just continue to praise you. We praise you for the power of the gospel that is you unleash in our lives, and you break the stronghold of sin. You spin our understanding of suffering. You refresh our souls, even in our darkest hour, all because of the truth that you've revealed to us in your word, all because of your Spirit's work in our hearts, enlivening our souls, giving us spiritual life, raising us from spiritual death. We were dead in our trespasses and sins, and you saw fit to choose us and to breathe spiritual life into us when we trust Christ as our Savior. We're so thankful for the sacrifice that he made on our behalf so that we could have the gift of heaven. We don't deserve any of that, and we're so thankful for it. Father, we want to take just a moment to really consider where we stand before you so that we can come into your presence boldly, like we just sang. We understand, though, that before we can come boldly, we've got to come humbly. So would you take just a moment? Would you reflect on where you stand before the Lord this morning? Just consider what sin you might be bringing into his presence, how you might need to do business with God before you hear from his word. Is there anything that is getting in between the way, that's getting in the way of you and God this morning that you need to confess with him? Would you just take a moment and do that right now? Father, thank you for making it possible that if we confess our sins before you, you are faithful to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's amazing, God. We rejoice in that. Father, we boldly want to ask that you would be with us this morning in our worship, in our time in your word. We don't want to just be listeners here. We don't want to be hearers only, but we also want to be doers. We want to be livers of your word. God, we want to be on mission for you. You have given us a high calling, and we so badly want to be a part of that. It's the most exciting thing in the world. We're thankful for the opportunity that we have, and we want to engage that as clean vessels for you. So, God, would you purify our hearts, purify our hands. We want to be completely yielded, surrendered to you. All our anxieties, all our cares, we want to cast them upon you right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're continuing in our series, Unfaithful. Emphasis, of course, being on faithful, the faithful God that we have, even in our times of unfaithfulness. And so we've been really privileged to hear from one of our deacons each week through the course of this series. And we're so grateful for their leadership in our church and just for the godly men that God has raised up in our midst and put into key positions like this. And so this morning we have the pleasure of hearing from Matt Stroud.
Good morning. So Pastor Jeff asked the deacons a while back if we'd be willing to do this, and I said, that'd be great, absolutely, anything I can do to help. Then he follows up a couple weeks later, says, 2 to 3 minutes. And I said, I've been working on this. I'm like at maybe 9.5 or 10. I'm going to have to cut it down. But so I did some major cutting here, Pastor Jeff, because I thought about it. I'm used to, if somebody gives me a microphone in front of a room full of people, A, that's a risk, but B, it's something that I'm used to looking at from the lens of an educator. For those of you who don't know, I've spent 20 plus years in education, teaching, principling, directing curriculum, whatever it is that we do. So I'm used to the one instructing large groups of people. But I realize that what Pastor Jeff is asking is more like, I'm the student here and it's show and tell. So I'm just trying to give a 2 to 3 minute show and tell of the faithfulness of God and what he's done in my life. And I'm really grateful to Pastor Jeff, and I'm thankful that right now we're in the middle of a study of the Old Testament, because I think the Old Testament sometimes gets overlooked. There's a lot of emphasis in churches on the New Testament, and that's not wrong, of course, but we don't want to overlook any part of the Bible and what God has shown us about who he is. And for me in particular, because I look at my own testimony, I don't have a Stephen or a Paul testimony. I don't have a dramatic moment. I'm one of those kids who was saved at a young age, raised in a Christian home, brought up in a really good church. But as I look back and reflect on my testimony and on the way God has shown himself to be faithful in my life, it really parallels a lot of the stories in the Old Testament. He's called me to do some stuff that was really not comfortable, really not what I wanted, not what I had planned. So as an example, just the way he brought us to this church. So I mentioned I was saved in a church, grew up in a church, good preaching, Bible-believing church, super comfortable in that church. Grown up there, I was saved there, I was baptized there, Joel was baptized there, we were married there, my kids were going there. You know, we were so comfortable that when it was time for junior church to leave and go out, every Sunday Eric would stop up at the front and have a little conversation with the pastor. And Joel and I were always cringing, saying, what's he going to say? What's he going to say? Usually it was just a hi, pastor, but sometimes it was a little bit more, to the point where pastor would wait. He wouldn't start saying anything to the congregation until he and Eric had their conversation. We were entrenched in that church, and it was just so familiar to us, and we just knew that's where God wanted us to be until it wasn't. And God started working on me and saying, you're here because you're comfortable. You're here because this is where your parents brought you. You're here because this is all you know. You need to go somewhere else. You need to do something else for yourself, for your family. And so he brought us here, and we've been here for the past 17 years, and it's just been a privilege and a joy to see the way he's used this church to grow me through things like Joshua's Men, to grow my family through things like youth group, Patch the Pirate, relationships that we've developed in this church that challenge us on a daily basis, friendships that we've developed in this church that really help us do life. Just some amazing connections that have been made. And it's because, as God did so often in the Old Testament, he called us out of a place of comfort and a place of familiarity and said, no, you need to do something else. And we didn't know where that was. We just knew it was something different. And he brought us here. And it's helped us over the years with other situations that have come up as well. Things like raising kids. We didn't know how to raise kids. I still don't know how to raise kids. Don't come to me asking for child-rearing advice. I mean, I'll talk to you, but you take that advice at your own peril. We face different situations, you know, dramatic job changes. I like to tell people I left my high school English classroom on a Friday afternoon and woke up Monday morning as the elementary school principal. That's a huge shift. That's an uncomfortable shift. And if it weren't for God's hand working through that stuff, it doesn't happen. All right, and it's taking those steps of obedience. And over the years, it's gotten a little bit, I won't say easier, but more comfortable, because I'm able to look back and see, he's done this, he's done this, he's done this, he's done this. All right, and we know that he's going to continue doing those things for us in the future. So I don't know where you are today. I don't know what decisions you might be facing, but I would just like to encourage you that if you're facing a moment where you're a little bit apprehensive, you're a little bit uncertain, you don't know where God wants you to be or what he wants you to do, take some time and reflect back. Think about what he's already done for you. Think about where he's brought you. Think about what he has shown you in the past. Lately, I've been reading through the Psalms in my devotions, and Psalm 77 is an interesting psalm. It's not a psalm of David. It's a psalm of Asaph. And the first half of that psalm, that guy's in anguish. If you read through it, he is just hurting. We don't really know why he's hurting or what it is that he's facing, but he's facing some really, really difficult times and some trials, and he's not finding relief anywhere. He's searching for answers. He's searching for relief. He's searching for some sort of guidance and direction, and he just can't come up with it. And then there's a turning point. I think it's verse 12, 13, somewhere in the middle there. And he says, I'm going to think back to what God has done. I'm going to reflect on what God has shown me. I'm going to reflect on the deeds that I know of God rescuing the children of Israel, working through the lives of Old Testament heroes and leaders. And that brings him the peace that he's looking for, that brings him the assurance that I don't have the answers right now. I don't know where I'm going, but I know who God is and what he's done, and I know I can put my trust in him for the future. So I just want to leave you with that today. Thank you.
Before I go any further, I have to wish a very happy birthday to my mom. She's a super sweet lady. If you haven't had the opportunity to meet my mom, you need to meet her. And wish her a happy birthday this morning. I love her. All right, we're in Judges chapter 6. We're going to be talking about Gideon this morning. Matt mentioned a key word that you're going to hear throughout the course of my message, and it's this word, comfort, or being comfortable. And of course, you know, if you've attended here for any length of time, that God has not called us to be comfortable. This morning we look at a character who is uncomfortable, but for some very different reasons that oftentimes you and I are comfortable. He's actually very insecure. Have you ever experienced that? Where you lean into being comfortable because you are just so dramatically insecure and you're fearful. That's what Gideon is like. And so Judges chapter 6, verse 1. Here we go. The people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. You remember this? We should be used to this by now. This is the cycle of self-destruction. They're on it. The Lord gave them into the hand of Midian for 7 years. So we see here their deconstruction and the Lord giving them over, their distress as a result of their choices. The hand of Midian overpowered Israel, and because of Midian, the people of Israel made for themselves the dens that are in the mountains and the caves and strongholds. Instead of driving out the Midianites, what are they doing? Hiding in caves. They have left behind their homes and they're living in the dirt. For whenever the Israelites planted crops, the Midianites and the Amalekites and the people of the east would come up against them. They would encamp against them, devour the produce of the land. This is kind of like the IRS here. Whatever you get, they're taking it. And as far as Gaza, they leave no sustenance in Israel and no sheep or ox or donkey. They take it all. For they would come up with their livestock and their tents. They would come like locusts in number. Both they and their camels could not be counted, so that they laid waste the land as they came in. And Israel was brought very low because of Midian. Worst oppression yet in the book of Judges. They're forced to leave their homes. They're starving. Everything is devoured. They have absolutely nothing. They've been stripped of it all. I'll tell you what, sometimes our choices to be disobedient toward God and not following in his way cost us everything. The end of verse 6 here, and the people of Israel cried out for help to the Lord. Here they are in their distress, turning once again to God. But were they really repentant? Because there's a difference between being sorry about your circumstances and feeling sorry for yourself and wishing that you weren't experiencing the consequences of your choices that you are. There's a difference between that kind of crying out and the kind of crying out that's actually repentance, where, oh God, please forgive me for that. That, I am done with that. I am disgusted by that. I am done. Here's my life, it's yours. See, that's repentance. There's a difference between emotionalism and crying out, being sorry, in essence that you got caught or now you're in trouble having to pay the price, and actual biblical repentance. I don't see any demonstration of biblical repentance at this point in Israel's history. So when the people of Israel cried out to the Lord on account of the Midianites, the Lord sent a prophet to the people of Israel. This is different than what we've seen up to this point in the book. Because up to this point, the people that the Lord sends as intervention on behalf of the people of Israel are deliverers. They're judges. They are tribal, military, mafia, thug types that are going to deliver them militarily and help them drive out the people of the land. But here he sends a prophet. And evidently, apparently at this point, God has determined that what Israel needs more than salvation from starvation is that they need a sermon. They need the truth. They need to be confronted with the reality of who they are, the choices that they're making, and they need to see the repercussions of it. There's a good lesson for us in that, that we have to understand what we're saved from before God can do a saving work in our heart. You can't be saved if you don't even know what you're saved from. So the Israel sends a prophet to the people of Israel. And he said to them, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I led you up from Egypt, I brought you out of the house of slavery, and I delivered you from the hand of the Egyptians, from the hand of all who oppressed you, and drove them out before you, and gave you their land. And I said to you, I am the Lord your God. You shall not fear the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But you have not obeyed my voice." Verse 11, the angel of the Lord came and sat under the terebinth at Ophrah. If you ever wonder where Oprah got her name, this might be it. Which belonged to Joash the Abizrite, while his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the wine press to hide it from the Midianites. Look, there's something here that doesn't belong. Gideon does not belong threshing wheat in a wine press. If you understand this historically, a wine press is not the place to thresh out wheat. In other words, he's hiding. Because they would never think it's not the season for wine. It's harvest season. They're bringing the wheat in, and they've got to do it in obscure locations. Why? So that the Midianites don't come and take what they want. So here we have this fearful man named Gideon. And this is really representative of the spiritual condition of the entire nation, because we see them fleeing for their lives and taking up residence in the mountains and in the caves, running in fear. There are a lot of Christians that live this way too. And I wonder if sometimes when God looks at us, if maybe he doesn't see something that looks a little like this. Chameleon Christians. They don't stand out. Their light doesn't shine for Christ. They're just blending in. Chameleon Christians blending in with the culture around them. At this point in the story, there's no difference between Gideon and the Israelites and the Midianites, the people of the land who are worshiping pagan gods. We had years ago, we have boys, and so of course, when you have boys, you tend to have critters. And so we got one of these critters, and so I want to introduce you to Linda. Linda has since gone on to be in a better place. I'll tell you how that happened in just a minute. But it was amazing how Linda could blend in with her surroundings. Here you see her blending in with a Christmas cactus. Really amazing how this would happen. So we would take Linda into these really fun places. She loved to eat flowers. That might sound strange to you, but so we would set her on the flowers outside so she could get some natural light and then forget about her. Boys would get to playing and, oh my goodness, where's Linda? And then there would be this massive hunt for Linda. She could be anywhere in the yard. And we would find her up on the fence. One time she got loose in the house, I think because we forgot her in the Christmas cactus or something. And we found her curled up on an extension cord. We had looked amazing how this thing could blend in with an extension cord and the wall. We had turned over the mattresses, hauled out the closets, and Linda was nowhere to be found. Ultimately, we trained Linda to eat from our hands, and so anything that we flicked around in our hands that would move, they had that tongue that snatches things. And so one of our poor sons, who still feels bad about this today, fed her something that didn't agree with her, and she died. So, yeah, monarch caterpillars are poisonous. So, yeah. Rest in peace, Linda. So, is this what you look like as a Christian? I've struggled with this before. I know sometimes I have. This is not where I want to live as a Christian, and I know you don't want to either. So, what happens next in the story is the angel of the Lord appears to Gideon in the wine press and says to him, now look at this, this is not supposed to make sense to you. And I'll show you why in a minute. He says to him, the Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor. That is the furthest thing from what we see in Gideon right now. Now, rather than me explaining to you some of the dynamics here, I want to kind of color this in with a video clip that I think compellingly illustrates this.
You know my father?
Correction, I know your father.
I hate to tell you this, but he died a long time ago.
Nope, wrong again.
He's alive, and I'll show him to you. You follow old Rafiki, he knows the way. Come on. Don't dawdle. Hurry up!
Hey, whoa, wait.
Come on. Come on!
Would you slow down? Come on.
Stop!
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Back. I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please, don't leave me.
Remember.
Father.
Remember.
At this point in the story, Gideon has forgotten who he is. And as a result, he has forgotten who God is. The entire nation of Israel. And they have just blended in. They've adopted this same kind of Hakuna Matata mentality. The one thing that I would disagree with in the video clip is Mufasa's advice that he has to look within himself. No. The turning point in The Lion King was not Simba looking within himself. It was him looking to his father. That's the turning point in the story. That's the turning point in our lives, too. Everything changes for Gideon in just a few minutes in this account when he realizes that the angel of the Lord is God himself that's appeared to him. And God is telling him, you have forgotten who I am. And as a result, you have forgotten who you are. Remember who you are. So what do we need to do if we're going to fulfill our calling, like God is setting Gideon up to do? What do we need to do? Well, number one, we've got to start here in verse 13. Gideon said to him, "Please, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then is all this happening to us? Where did all his wonderful deeds that our fathers recounted to us, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us from Egypt?' But now the Lord has forsaken us, given us into the hand of Midian." If you're going to fulfill your calling, you've got to start here. You have to reject false beliefs. This is what we see Simba doing, if you're familiar with the story of the Lion King. He can't go anywhere out of his Hakuna Matata lifestyle and into the pride land until he rejects the false beliefs that he's accepted. What are the false beliefs that are holding you back from fulfilling the calling that God has upon your life? We all struggle with them. Satan lies to me just like he lies to you. I've seen this a couple times floating around. I'm not sure who it's original with, but Satan's top 10 lies. And these are in the app notes. If you're following along there, taking notes, and we'd encourage you to do so. If you don't have the app, just download Grace Batavia. Satan's top 10 lies. Number one, God doesn't care about you. Number two, nobody cares about you. Everyone is doing it. No one will know. Go ahead. You deserve it. Or, that's just the way that I am. It's too hard. God doesn't really mean that. You can't do anything right. Number 10, everyone would be better without you. Top 10 lies that Satan tells. What are the false beliefs rolling around in your mind and heart that you have come to believe about yourself that are stopping you from fulfilling your calling? Verse 14, the Lord turned to Gideon and said, "Now go in this might of yours." Man, what might? Crazy. Save Israel. Save Israel. The guy threshing wheat in the wine press? Save Israel from the hand of Midian. Do not I send you. This is God's calling upon Gideon's life. You know, and God, so at this point, God says to Gideon, you know, you asked me the question, or you accuse me of forsaking you, and you're asking the question, where are all my mighty deeds? And yet, here God is standing right in front of him. He's actually talking to God. While Gideon's asking the question why God has forsaken him. See, he is so entrenched in the lies, he is so bamboozled and befuddled by them that he can't even see God when he's right in front of him. That can be symptomatic of the depth of our own deception sometime too. Reject the lies. God is telling Gideon, look at Gideon, you are the work of God in your generation. This is on your shoulders. Same is true of us. So number two, if we're going to fulfill our calling, you have to remember who you are. Remember who you are. That you are the work of God in your generation. You are the work of God in your generation. Is your generation seeing it? Or is your Christianity, is Christ in you invisible to them because you're a chameleon Christian? Are you asking God, why aren't you active in my life? Why aren't you active in my school? Why aren't you active in my home? Why aren't you active in my workplace? Why aren't you active in my church? Maybe it's not God. Maybe God is saying to you, no, you have it backward. You are the answer to your prayer. So we've got to stop hiding behind our phones, creating false images of ourselves on social media, trying to be Insta-famous, TikTok notorious, whatever social media you're choosing these days. Instead, be the conduit of my power. That's what God's calling us to do. So what wine presses are you soaking in? What wine presses are you soaking in that you're actually using to conceal your faith? Because when it comes to you and God, you're really actually pretty insecure. You got to remember who you are. Reject the false beliefs. Remember who you are. You are the work of God in your generation. Let me prove it to you. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, therefore, we're ambassadors for Christ. You represent him. You are his spokesperson. Making his appeal through us. That's how God is appealing to people and compelling people. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. That's the ministry that that passage tells us that God has given us. If you've been reconciled to God, you have this ministry of reconciliation, where once you were an enemy of God, you have not just become a friend of God if you've trusted Christ as your Savior, but you have become his son. You've become his daughter. You're his child. You have the ability to minister that reconciliation to others now. Look at Matthew chapter 20. You are the light of the world. This is who you are. This isn't just what you do. It's actually who you are. It's part of your identity. Remember who you are. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket. That'd be ridiculous, like threshing wheat in a wine press, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. Are you standing in such a way that people can see Christ in you? In the same way, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who's in heaven. Philippians chapter 2. Do all things without grumbling or disputing. Some interesting connections here. That my complaining and whining and bellyaching actually impacts the ability for other people to see Christ in me. That you may be blameless and innocent, children of God, without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Wow. Holding fast to the word of life so that in the day of Christ, I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. You are the work of God in your generation. So I mentioned the angel of the Lord and it actually being God himself. Well, how do we know that? Well, if you go back to verse 15 or verse 12, you know, he's called an angel, and he talks about the Lord in the third person. But then in verse 14, he's called the Lord directly. And that happens a lot in Hebrew. And it's a mystery until the coming of Jesus. And after that, it makes sense. It's what theologians call a theophany or a Christophany, where Jesus Christ himself, the Son of God. See, a lot of Christians don't realize this. They think that Jesus Christ was born in a manger 2,000 years ago, but didn't exist before then. No, that's just when he put on flesh and came as a human being. Jesus Christ is God, and as God, he has lived for all of eternity. He has no beginning, and he has no end. And he's the creator of the universe. That's who Jesus Christ is. This angel is him. Jesus is the messenger of God. It's God himself. Look, we see more demonstration of this in back to Judges chapter 6, now verse 15. Gideon said to him, "Please, Lord," he's beginning to recognize, no longer realizing he's talking to an angel or just any celestial being. He's identified him here. "Please, Lord, how can I save Israel? Behold, my clan's the weakest in Manasseh. I'm the least in my father's house. I'm just a runt." And the Lord said to him, "But I will be with you." You may want to underline that in your Bible. That is God's answer to everything. When you actually realize what that means, and you soak yourself in that truth, it changes the way you view and approach everything. I can't believe how many times, especially as a youth pastor, I would talk with young people, and they would say, "Well, I've just kind of graduated from Sunday school answers. My problems are too complicated for that." God is the author of your soul. He created you, created me. He knows exactly what we need. And oftentimes, this is his answer to your problem. I am with you. And you shall strike the Midianites as one man. So we've got to remember who we are. We reject false beliefs, and we've got to root ourselves in God's promises. Root yourself in God's promises. The power of God's promises, reciting to them to yourself, they have a way of relinquishing the grip that the world holds upon your heart. So we look at verse 17 and we see this exchange here and how this works out. He said to him, Gideon says to God, if I have found favor in your eyes, then show me a sign. Now this becomes a theme to Gideon, but perhaps maybe not for the reason that you might think. Show me a sign that it's you who speak with me. You have to understand, it doesn't appear that Gideon has any knowledge of God at this point. Because remember, at the beginning of Judges, what's explained to us is that there is a generation that came after Joshua that did not know God or the mighty works that he had done. At this point in the story, you cannot distinguish the Israelites between the Canaanites, the Midianites, or anybody else who dwelt in the land. God has revealed himself to Gideon, and Gideon is just starting to learn who he is. Please do not depart from here until I come to you and bring out my present and set it before you. And he said, I will stay until you return. So Gideon went into his house, prepared a young goat and unleavened cakes from an ephah of flour. The meat he put in a basket, the broth he put in a pot, he brought them to him under the terebinth and presented him to them. And the angel of God said to him, take the meat and the unleavened cakes, put them on this rock, and pour the broth over them. God is continuing to reveal himself to him. And he did so. And then the angel of the Lord reached out the tip of the staff that was in his hand, touched the meat and the unleavened cakes. Fire sprang up from the rock and consumed the meat and the unleavened cakes, and the angel of the Lord vanished from his sight. Then Gideon perceived that he was the angel of the Lord, and Gideon said, alas, O Lord God, for now I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face. He thinks he's going to die because he's seen God. The Lord said to him, peace be to you. Do not fear. You shall not die. Another one of God's promises to Gideon. And Gideon built an altar there to the Lord and called it, the Lord is peace. And to this day, it still stands at Ophrah, which belongs to the Abizrites. Root yourself in God's promises. What are God's promises to you? We're going to look at some of those in just a moment. But number four here, remain faithful no matter the cost. Remain faithful no matter the cost. If you're going to fulfill your calling, you've got to remain faithful no matter the cost. Verse 25, that night the Lord said to him, take your father's bull, the second bull, 7 years old, pull down the altar of Baal that your father has. Do you see this? They were idol worshipers. They were indistinguishable between them and there was no distinction between them and the pagans of the land. There's idol worship in their very house. Cut down the Asherah that is beside it. Build an altar there to the Lord your God on top of the stronghold there with stones laid in due order. Then take the second bull, offer it as a burnt offering with the wood of the Asherah that you shall cut down. Do you understand what God has called Gideon to do? He's telling him, look at Gideon, revival first has to start in your own heart. Then it will spread to your home. Here's what you have to do in your own home, but it can't stay there. Your light has to so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your fathers in heaven. This has to spread to your community. Trevor Horzempa, one of our band members, drew this picture of this scene. And if you look closely there, you can see on the left, you can see Gideon hacking away at the Asherah pole and using the oxen to pull down the altar Baal that's beside it. I love this depiction. And like a wild man, he's going to town on this thing. Awesome, awesome depiction. Thank you for that, Trevor. But we blend in to the culture around us. We become compromised chameleon Christians. Rather than demolishing the altars and the Asherah poles that we've erected in our lives and that we look to for comfort and hope and security. See, they were worshiping God. They were worshiping God. Just like we do. You came here to a formal, official church event, Sunday morning service. But are you worshiping God relationally? See, there's a difference between being in church and being in Christ. A lot of people who call themselves Christians just go to church, and they think they're Christians because they go to church, but they're not actually in Christ. See, we see the distinction here in the text. See, when you blend in with the world, you extinguish your light. When you blend in with the world, you extinguish your light. So Gideon's first assignment was to get rid of the idols in his father's house. Before you can do battle with anything else and be effective as a light in the world, you got to throw off the enemies that are within you. These idols, these desires of your heart that rage against your desire for God, they weaken you. They dim your light. They make you ineffective. So you might say, I don't have any idols. I mean, that's, you know, they carve stuff out of soap and stone and wood. And I don't have that thing living in my house. That's not what my backyard looks like. No, of course not. But it's no different today. You've put plenty of things. There are plenty of things that you are depending upon for to get something that you want. There are plenty of things that you're looking to and hoping in that they will deliver to you what you're looking for and what you want and what you think you need. That is not God. And that's what the Bible calls idols. So where are the places in your life that you aren't really sure that you can trust God? And so you have to look to other things as a backup. What are those things? So let me give you two sure signs of an idol. Here's how you gauge if you have idols in your life. Number one, disobedience. What are the areas where you're disobeying God? Guaranteed, every time. There are no exceptions to this. There is an idol behind that. What are you anxious about? What's causing you to fret and worry and fear? Without exception, every single time, there's an idol behind that. Two sure signs of an idol: disobedience and anxiety. Where there's smoke, there's fire. No exception. Hey, so you might think to yourself, you know, God, I all I want is just to someday be happily married. I mean, if I'm going to be happy, I've got to be married. And so you can't stand being patient. You can't stand waiting for this. And so you have sex with your boyfriend or your girlfriend. You take matters into your own hands to have the intimacy that you're looking for. And you don't trust God. You don't trust God with your relationships. You don't trust Him with your heart. You don't trust Him for intimacy. Other people feel like they couldn't be happy without a certain level of income. And so they cheat, either in business or on their taxes. They harm their family working all the time. They refuse to obey God financially. Do you tithe? And I know I'm stepping on toes here. I don't care about your money as a pastor. You have to understand that. God's charged me with caring for your heart. Jesus has connected the two. He said, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. I have to talk to you about money. I've seen it in my own life. You know, one of the things that I've learned from my wife, she has modeled this so well, and I was thinking about this actually on my ride home from the base last night. It's this statement: if I'm not generous, I'm selfish. If you're not generous, you're selfish. Do you tithe? Is God the Lord of your finances? Do you trust Him enough to tithe? As Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. If you don't tithe, that indicates that money is an idol for you. See, disobedience and anxiety are sure signs of an idol. How does that plug into your view of finances? Well, you can't blend in with the world and shine for Christ. So look at here at our story now in verse 27. So Gideon took 10 men of his servants. He did as the Lord had told him, but because he was too afraid of his family and the men of the town to do it by day, he did it by night. He's still dealing with the fear. You've got to remain faithful no matter the cost. Gideon's wrestling with this. You've got to obey in the face of fear. Obey in the face of fear. Look what it says in Galatians chapter 6, 9. Some of you need to hear this because this is you. You've grown weary. Let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. What's got you weary? See, if you've got opposition in your life right now that is challenging your resolve to remain faithful, what's the answer? It's not easy. You've got to stay faithful no matter the cost. Look at verse 28 here, Judges 6. When the men of the town rose early in the morning, behold, the altar of Baal was broken down. The Asherah beside it was cut down. The second bull was offered on the altar that had been built. And they said to one another, who's done this thing? And after they had searched and inquired, they said, Gideon, the son of Joash, has done this thing. And then the men of the town said to Joash, bring out your son that he may die. He's broken down the altar of Baal, cut down the Asherah beside it. But Joash said to all who stood against him, will you contend for Baal? Or will you save him? Whoever contends for him shall be put to death by morning, because if he's a god, let him contend for himself. But his altar has been broken down. See, Gideon's own father, the one who possessed the idols in his own home, is coming to the realization of what those idols are and the stronghold that they've had upon his own heart and his own home, and the destruction that they've wreaked in his life. And therefore, on that day, Gideon was called Jerubbaal. That is to say, let Baal contend against him, because he broke down his altar. Gideon's very name here, his new name, Jerubbaal, is a confrontation to Israel. It confronts Israel with a choice. Will they follow God, the only one who can truly deliver them, or are they going to follow the lesser gods of the culture and continue to blend in as chameleon Christians? Joshua 24:15, I love how Joshua puts this. Maybe you can advance that for me. I'm stuck. Thank you. Choose this day whom you will serve, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We've got a choice to make. So number five, looks like my remote is dead. You got to respond to your culture with truth. Respond to your culture with truth. You want to strengthen your faith? You got to start talking about your faith. That is strengthening your faith on steroids. See, those who share their faith grow in their faith. There's a one-to-one correlation there. And lo and behold, God uses them, and they are the ones who make a difference. I was so excited to talk with a young man last week who shared with me after the service that he was purposing in his heart to do this, and he was talking about just how amazing it was, and he wished he had started sharing his faith sooner. Because as he has been talking about his faith, at the same time, God is growing his faith, and he's becoming more real to him. Amazing. What's the outcome of that? Well, lo and behold, people respect and follow leaders with clear conviction. People respect and follow leaders with clear conviction. Look down at verse 33 now. Now all the Midianites, the Amalekites, the people of the east came together, and they crossed the Jordan and camped in the valley of Jezreel. But the Spirit of the Lord clothed Gideon, and he sounded the trumpet. The Abizrites were called out to follow him. He sent messengers throughout all Manasseh. They too were called out to follow him. And he sent messengers to Asher, Zebulun, Naphtali, and they went up to meet him. He's calling the nation of Israel to battle. Then Gideon said to God, if you will save Israel by my hand as you have said, behold, I'm laying a fleece of wool on the threshing floor. If there's dew on the fleece alone, you're familiar with this story, some of you, right? This is the good old fleece test. Then I shall know that you will save Israel by my hand as you have said. And it was so. He rose early the next morning, he squeezed the fleece, he wrung the dew out from the fleece to fill a bowl with water. I don't know if you've ever done this. Okay, God, if you want me to do this, do this for me. If I'm going to do this, God, please do this. Please show up in this way. Please show me that this is your will. And that's not the way that God has charged us to seek his will. So what's going on here? Remember, Gideon is learning who God is. He's learning who God is. So pick up in verse 39, when Gideon said to God, "Let not your anger burn against me. Let me speak just once more. I'm still trying to get a handle on who you are, God. Please let it be dry on the fleece only, and on all the ground let there be dew." And God did so that night. And it was dry on the fleece only, and on all the ground there was dew. See, Gideon, this isn't so much a test of faith. Gideon trying to, you know, put a fleece out there to see if it was God's will that he should rise up against the Midianite. He was seeking to know God. He was trying to understand the character of God because he had been so tainted by the character of the pagan gods who had done nothing but deceive him and disappoint him. And this God that he's confronted with is very different. Here's what you've got to do, number six. If you're going to fulfill your calling, you've got to renew your faith in the Lord. You've got to renew your faith in the Lord. Mark chapter 9, verse 24 says this. Immediately the father of the child cried out and said, "I believe." This man with a sick child comes to Jesus and is begging him for help on behalf of his child. And he says to him, "I believe, Lord, help my unbelief." What does this show us? You may be struggling with fear and with doubt, but this is exactly where Jesus wants to meet you, in your unbelief. Gideon's struggling with unbelief. How do we do that? Well, Jesus has given us something so much better than a fleece. So much better. He's given us the cross. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. "But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Look at God says to you, "Go, mighty man of valor. I am with you." Is he calling you to take off your camouflage, to stop fearing what people think? Here's what he says about who you are. Called Gideon a mighty man of valor. Here's what he says to you. You are a saint, highly beloved in Christ. You are my ambassador. He says to you, you are my son or daughter. He says, "I will never leave you or forsake you. So be strong and very courageous, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." See, we don't have to muster up the courage. It doesn't come from our personality. It comes from our embracing our identity in Christ. Look, you don't look to your courage to have an identity or to give you an identity in Christ. You look to your identity in Christ. You look to him to give you courage. Remember who you are. Remember whose you are. Please pray with me. Father, that's what we want to do. We want to reject and cast out the lies that would seek to rain terror and destruction in our lives, that would sabotage us, that would cause us to make sinful decisions, that would pull us away from you, that would cause us to put our trust in other things to make us happy and content and to give us joy and hope and fulfillment to satisfy us. So much stuff. God, we need you to help us to clear the clutter. Help us to reject the false beliefs, to remember who we are, that we're your work in this generation. You've called us to remain faithful no matter the cost. Would you just take a moment and just have a private, personal conversation with God in your heart? Let me ask you a question. Are you secure in your relationship with God? Do you know where you stand before him? I mean, you're not ashamed of him. You're not afraid to let your light shine. You value your relationship with him more than what anyone else thinks about you. If this is an issue for you and you know you're not living up to your calling to let Christ be seen in you, in your culture, would you just confess that to the Lord right now and ask for his help? Father, we want to be your work on display in this generation. God, we want you to be fulfilling the advancement of the gospel through our lives. God, would you use us? In Jesus' name, amen. We want to serve you in any way that we possibly can to help you know for certain that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, for you to be able to experience security in him, for you to be able to fulfill your calling in him. If we can help you do that in any way, it would be the highest privilege of our lives. You can contact the church. You can reach us online. We would love to be able to do so. So until next week, may the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. We'll see you next week.